The first steps that a lot of photographers take when getting into real estate photography are often the last steps that should have been taken. I've seen this a lot, where a lot of photographers have come to me after the fact and realized that now they're having problems sustaining clients, getting the right type of work, and they're hurting because some of the steps were taken out of order and they didn't really start their photography business the right way. So, as you probably know, I've shot literally thousands of homes here in Southern California. I worked with hundreds of clients, and I've done this for a long time. And I wouldn't have the success I have now and the clients that I have now and the steady work I have now if it wasn't for taking the proper steps. Because, I mean, let's face it, I mean, starting a real estate photography business, you could do that in an afternoon. That's not hard. You could start almost any business in an afternoon, come up with a name, put it out there, and hey, you've got a photography business. Come up with a great website, whatever it is that you want to do to get started as a business. But those are some of the last steps if you're trying to get into something that's a skill trade. That's what real estate photography is. So if you do take the proper steps, if you really start out right, you can get into real estate photography to then have a sustainable business that fits what you want for your hours and your income. And this first step, it's very simple, but it's so often overlooked, probably because it is so simple, is you have to visualize if this is something that you really want to do. Now, I know that may sound California hippie, crunchy granola eating, tree hugging. Yes, let's visualize where we'll be in 10 years, but it's not that. It really is. And almost applies to just about every business is that, do you really see yourself doing this? Because doing real estate photography is not like doing photography for enjoyment. Now, I do love real estate photography. Don't get me wrong. I'd rather be doing this than almost anything else. But it's different from going out and just taking pictures of landscapes or taking portraits, having fun photography outings. When you're doing photography as a business, real estate photography is that way. You do have client demands, you have deadlines, you've got client issues that do come up. You have to show up on time. You necessarily just can't call in sick. So there are differences when you're doing photography as a business compared to doing it as just some fun, enthusiast hobby, enjoying your art, whatever it is that you're creating that's non-business-like. Now, that doesn't mean that I want to discourage you from being a real estate photographer. I am. I've been one for many years, and I wouldn't change a thing. For me, the decision was easy, visualizing that I wanted to be able to do this and I wanted to do it full time. As you may know, I used to be an engineer and a meteorologist, and that was just such a strain on my life of sitting inside of a cubicle all day long and coding. It was really fun at first, but after a while of doing that, I started realizing that there was something else I wanted to do, and I had always loved photography. When I tried a lot of different genres and I fell into real estate photography, light bulb moment, it wasn't just about making money, but I could see myself getting up every day and doing this. And when it comes to the money, and that's where people think that, well, you know, would you make enough doing this? I used to be an engineer. I was an engineering manager even, and a software architect for some very large projects over the years. But it came down to, first, do I really want to do this? Yes, definitely want to do it. I could visualize. I could see myself in this first step that, yes, I could do this. And sure enough, after a while, I was making more money than I was being an engineer anyways. And that leads up to the second step. You have to not just visualize that, you know, is this something you can wake up and do every day, day in and day out, but is this going to be worthwhile? And, you know, you can get out a spreadsheet, you can start running the numbers, and I talk about that in my business techniques book, but it really boils down to the fact that if you're worried about the money, you're probably not going to have to worry about the money, because real estate photography is that one genre of photography that it does have a low barrier to entry to get into, and it has steady work. The reason being is that, you know, you think about other genres of photography when you're doing weddings or portraits. A lot of times these are one-off things. You can get referrals if you shot a wedding, but when you're doing real estate photography, you've got the same clients coming back over and over and over and over again. to have you shoot their properties, whether that's for listing houses for sale or rentals that are going to be available on the market, or also for architects and for designers and builders as they, like for instance, remodel companies, as they do new kitchens and baths, they want to have really good professional photos taken of that. So there's a difference there. The money will follow. There's no doubt about that. And it's competitively priced enough that if you do this right and get into it, the money will be there. But is it going to be worthwhile for your time? So yes, visualizing that you could do this, you see yourself doing it. Do you want to do this part-time? Do you want to do this full-time? Will it be worthwhile for your time to get into real estate photography? For me, once again, the answer was yes, absolutely. And I knew the money would follow. I could see that it was there. I could see that other real estate photographers were making good money doing this. So it was kind of a no-brainer for me, but it's something that you have to ask yourself. Is this going to be something you want to do? Is it something you want to visualize? And then comes something that's actually kind of fun. And that's the third step in this, and that's building your skill set. So real estate photography is a skill trade. And no matter what you do to start your business, come up with a marketing plan, all that stuff that you may think starting a business requires, which it does to some degree, and I'm going to get to that here shortly, but nobody's going to hire you or want to come back and hire you again for repeat work unless you can prove that you're worth it. You have to show that you're as good or better than the competition that's out there. But this is the fun part. This is where you get to do what you love for photography. I mean, all of us photographers, we love getting gear. We love trying new things, getting those aha moments when it all comes together and we get an image that works just the way that we thought it would. So that is the fun part of learning it, but that's also some of the hardest part because where are you going to learn this? So as you know, I do have a lot of videos here on my YouTube channel, but I also have an online course for doing professional interior real estate photography. I've got an entire book series on doing real estate photography. Some of those have been bestsellers as well, and I've got links to all that down in the description for this video. But the next step is to consider what type of real estate photography you want to do. Now, there's two primary styles that will also dictate the type of work and the type of clients that you can get. Now, you may already know this, but the two primary types are HDR and flambient. Now, HDR is, you know, bracketed photos put together, no lights involved. Flambient is where you incorporate flash with ambient and you get a professional looking image. So if you are just working in the listing market, you may be able to squeak by with HDR. Flambient, by incorporating flash, gets you that high-end look, and if it's done properly, it doesn't take long to do, it doesn't take long to edit. In fact, it can take you less time to edit than doing HDR, and it opens more doors. So that's the route that I went, and you might think, well, I'm trying to push flambient instead of HDR. Well, I'll guarantee you that myself and a lot of other pros have tried HDR. We wanted it to work, but it just didn't to get the quality that we wanted to be able to get the clients that we wanted. So once again, the listing market, yeah, you could squeak by with HDR. If you go that route though, then there's a lot of other things to consider. Anybody can do HDR, and we call that run and gun. And that's where you just run through a property real quick, take a bunch of photos, and you'll have so much work that won't pay very much that you're going to struggle to then get an income compared to the amount of hours that you put into it. And that's why a lot of HDR photographers end up outsourcing their photos for editing to second and third world countries, basically exploiting poverty, quite honestly. But they do that because they need to get enough work throughout the day. They don't have enough time for editing just to break even and make a little bit of income. That's not the type of business that I want to do. It's not the type of business that I recommend. And that's why I do consider the flambient doing that. With doing that, the flambient method, you can get higher end clients. Yes, you'll get into luxury markets. And yes, I know that there are some luxury listings people take with their cell phones or do with HDR. That's outside of the mean. There's always going to be extremes and outliers. But when it comes down to the average, the mean, the most common method that you would see used when it comes to luxury markets and for designers, builders, and remodel companies, it's going to have an incorporation of flash in it. And that's what I teach. It's what's in my books. And that's also what's here throughout my videos on my YouTube channel as well. And by doing that, I'm not in a constant race to the bottom in pricing. That's what HDR does. You're just one of a dime a dozen. So that's why I do recommend, if you're gonna get into this, really consider building your skill set to learn the Flambient technique. You'll thank yourself later because you'll have a sustainable job. When we were talking about visualizing what you wanna do in step number one, and do you really feel that this would be worthwhile for your time, once you're about 2 or 3 years into running around, breaking even, making a little bit of money by doing HDR and in a constant race to the bottom in pricing, you're probably gonna wanna change your mind, or like many photographers that get into real estate, they become soured by it, they make a lot of excuses that all realtors are cheap and all this. That's a bunch of BS. You hear other people talk about realtors being cheap. They haven't tried to get high-end clients. They haven't done the higher-end work. So I'd encourage you to definitely take that route. The next steps is where you would really think about then starting a real estate photography business. First thing is, yeah, it's a paradox. You need to have a portfolio, but if you've had no jobs, how do you get pictures? How do you build a portfolio? Well, the answer is simple. I'll bet you you know somebody that has a really nice house. Maybe you do. You want to be able to photograph that. Now, start out by learning techniques in your own home. I don't care if you rent a room someplace or just a condo, an apartment, whatever it is. You live in a mobile home, it doesn't matter. Every place that you live, every home has a window, which will help you with things like window pulls. It'll help you to be able to judge lighting. You'll be able to do all kinds of experimentation because your home will be your lab. Don't worry about cleaning it. It'll be throwaway stuff, unless you're gonna use it to build your portfolio. And that's where you go in and your friend's house, or if you've got a nice house, you can start building some of these pictures. You don't need a lot. You keep it to a minimum because the next steps are gonna help you with that. The idea is you keep it very simple, the information you have out there. So next, consider putting together a simple website. Just some contact information, and don't use a contact form. It looks like you're in a third world country. You don't want to know who people are. Put your phone number on there. Put your email address in there. Nowadays, phone numbers come in. You don't know who it is. You just let it go to voicemail or whatever. If it becomes a problem, you block it. My phone number, my cell phone number that I have is on my website. And so is my email address. And yes, I do get calls from time to time by who knows who, and I just let that go to voicemail. And sometimes too, if I get some calls, by the way, from somebody, if you don't know about contacting me, please send me an email. It's the best way. Or comment also on one of my videos, including this one. Leave a comment with a question. It's one of the best ways to contact me, and that way I can keep my cell phone open for more business calls. But either way, put your phone number, put your email address out there with a few pictures of this is what you do, and it'll be enough for taking the next steps, which is where you need to start thinking about one or two clients. And believe it or not, that's really the next step compared to officially starting the business, because getting the work and getting the clients is more important than trying to decide if you want to incorporate, become an S corp or something else where you're going to worry about your taxes and what you're going to do. That's all easy. You just become a sole proprietor. You just have people write you checks or pay by credit card through like a PayPal account or Venmo or something that's just to you personally. That's how self-employment works. So you can start out that way, and yeah, you can get a better tax break if maybe you're an LLC or an S corp or something. Worry about that later. Worry about right now getting the client. So what you do, probably somehow through your 6 degrees of separation, you probably know somebody who is a realtor who then would need to have photos taken of their property. So after you've done some friends' houses, some houses that you can put in at least some pictures to show that you're worthy of the skill of doing this, reach out to one realtor, just one to start out. And you might think to yourself, well, I need money, I need income, I'm doing this full time. You could start out part-time if you wanted to, if you can reach out to one realtor. But the last thing you want to do is just the opposite. You don't want to broadcast to the world that you're not ready. It'll ruin your reputation. And remember when I first started this video, I was talking about how there was a lot of photographers coming to me, help, I need help, what do I do? And I give them some photography coaching, and it's almost too late because, well, they damaged their reputation by getting out there too early and not doing very good work. Word spreads. And this is an important thing that'll happen. If you get one client and you can do a job very well for this one client, give them a deep discount, right? The first client. What'll happen is every time your photos go onto the listing site, in the United States we call it the MLS, but once it's out there on a listing site, other real estate agents in the area will see those pictures because they're looking for houses for their buyers. So if they think those photos are really good, they're going to ask that listing agent, the client who hired you, who does your photos? And immediately you got a referral. And those are stronger referrals than if you were shooting weddings where, yeah, wedding photographer, it's a once in a lifetime thing. So they're going to look at about a dozen photographers. When it comes to real estate photography and somebody's got a listing that's coming up and they got to get pictures for it, they aren't going to spend a whole lot of time. It's like if they can get a recommendation from somebody they trust, they already see the work. Boom, they're probably gonna hire you for it. So that's how word of mouth spreads. In fact, a lot of people ask me, it's like, well, Nathan, how much do you spend per year on your marketing budget? Because I do have a lot of work that I do with a lot of clients. And the answer is, for all these years I've been doing it, my yearly marketing budget is zero, nada, zilch. Now, I do pay for a website every year, that's it. And I do have business expenses with cameras and lenses and flashes and things that just wear out over time or that I need to get new and improve. But when it comes to actually trying to sell myself out there, it's not that I'm like the best real estate photographer in the world. I would like to think so, but I'm not, and I admit that. The fact is that I do a good enough job to where I get noticed. I don't have to be the best out there, but I have to be noticed. I have to be better than the competition. And being better than the competition is pretty easy in real estate photography if you take the harder road initially, learning the flamboyant techniques so that you can do higher end work. And then that also, once again, leads to other type of work. But that'll help you build your portfolio so that you can go later to some of the higher paying clients in the luxury market, in the builder market, remodel company, all that type of stuff. So don't be afraid when you first start out to shoot mobile homes and to shoot condos, to shoot whatever you can, but shoot it like it's gonna go into a magazine. Just go just full bore on it to try to get really good results, because this is practice and it also is something you need to expect, which is your first year loss. Any business that you get into is going to take a loss the first year. You need to somehow sustain yourself during that. That either means that you keep your day job for a while working part-time, you have enough money to be able to sustain yourself doing this, but if you don't, you're gonna rush into it too fast, you're gonna make a lot of mistakes, you won't be able to take the time to, one, visualize what you wanna do, to be able to see if this is gonna be worthwhile, and to build your skill set. Those first three steps, which are so critical before actually starting a real estate photography business. And I also realize that there are some real estate photographers out there that are trying to promote their courses or their get-rich-quick schemes on how you can start a real estate photography business. Pay $1,000 for their course and you'll get rich overnight. That's just a bunch of BS. A lot of times, these real estate photography businesses, they'll concentrate on the fact that you'll hire a bunch of people to go out there and shoot for you, and then you'll outsource a lot of your work, and you just won't have a sustainable business model. Because here's the key. Here's the real key, and look for this. If you have to continually market yourself, then you don't have a sustainable real estate photography business. If you are good, you will easily stand out in real estate photography, and people will come to you and ask you to do work for them. You won't have to go the other way. But the first thing to do that is you gotta get good. You gotta get really good. You gotta make sure this is something that you wanna do, and then practice, learn the skills to do it, and the rest, quite honestly, will fall in place. And I hope that you would then have as much of an enjoyable career as I've had over many years now doing professional real estate photography.